The natural world is full of mysteries, ones that scientists study to better understand and protect organisms and ecosystems. But some could be pretty tough cases to crack. How do you track elusive invasive species as they gain footholds in new territories? Or find out what a whale eats when they're so hard to follow in the wild? How do you tally up all the creatures that live in a place you're trying to protect? The key to solving some of nature's biggest mysteries is to tap into the world of environmental DNA, revealing traces of plants and animals that are hiding in the shadows. Join us as we crack the code on nature and unlock mysteries in the Nature Files. If you've heard the word DNA recently, it might have been in the context of forensic science. You know, like CSI or another one of those detective shows. You probably know that DNA is present in all living organisms and that it is what makes a living thing what it is. This DNA is in our hair, our saliva, our blood, in every part of us, and we leave bits of it behind wherever we go. Which is why forensic scientists are always out there collecting these sorts of samples to find out who'd done it. But plants and animals have DNA too, and like a criminal leaving a strand of hair at the scene of a crime, organisms of all kinds leave DNA containing bits of themselves wherever they go. Environment, DNA, squish it together and you've got eDNA. The traces of a living creature's DNA found in their surrounding environment. More and more, eDNA is proving to be the smoking gun in all sorts of ocean mysteries. But how does it actually work in the field? For instance, how does DNA help you to find out which creatures have been living in a certain area, like this kelp forest? Well, first we need to take a sample of that environment. So step one is to collect some water, like how a detective might take a sample of blood from a crime scene. Next, we use a filter to separate out all the bits of dead skin cells and all sorts of other material that contain DNA from the water, and then it goes off to the lab, where the DNA will be extracted and sequenced. Because we're dealing with super small quantities of DNA, these samples can be easily contaminated, so every part of this process has to be sterile. Next, the samples are usually frozen until they are ready to be processed. This is to make sure that the samples don't degrade over time. Then it's a matter of extracting the DNA fragments from our sample. A process which first involves shaking and baking the samples to break down the cell walls and release the DNA. The samples then go through a wash cycle, ending in a good spin down to get rid of all but the DNA. From a 1 liter water sample, you're left with less than a drop of DNA. But this tiny amount of DNA is too little to move on to the next step. So we need to multiply it. We do this with a machine called a thermocycler. In go the DNA fragments, and after a series of calculated temperature changes, out come thousands of copies. We call this step of the process amplification. Finally, each DNA fragment we collected is ready to be decoded in a big fancy machine we call a sequencer. It converts the DNA sample into text that we can read, a long list of genetic sequences. It's amazing technology, but what we end up with is like a bunch of different fingerprints, each representing a different species that lives near where the water sample came from. Then, just like running fingerprints in a police database, we take the DNA sequences from all the fragments that were in our water samples and look for matches in a massive online database, a reference library. So, that researcher studying the kelp forest can learn that not only are the obvious species residents of this neighborhood, the greenling and the rockfish, but also amphipods and larval critters like the sea urchin, which you'd never see because they're so small. In fact, we really only ever observe a tiny fraction of the living creatures around us. Most are too small to see with just our eyes. But because they have DNA, we can detect them. Of course, this whole process is only possible when the online database has those species' fingerprints, or rather, DNA samples to begin with. So for decades, there have been global efforts to build up these reference libraries, such as BOLD, the Barcode of Life database, which has had over 15 million barcodes submitted to it, creating almost 100,000 unique organism fingerprints. So there you have it. eDNA is like the best nature detective tool ever, and its potential to be used to solve mysteries in the animal kingdom has almost no limits. Consider yourself briefed. So now that we understand the potential of eDNA, let's crack open our first case file. Next week on the Nature Files, we explore the case of the disappearing DNA and find out how a shrimp-like critter, no bigger than a fingernail clipping, might be the key to assessing the health of entire ecosystems.